pessoal, boa noite, obrigado por ter ficado aqui dessa hora. Esse painel vai ser em inglês, então só vou falar um pouquinho em português e já vou mudar para inglês. São só perguntas, vocês podem perguntar o que vocês quiserem. Caso ninguém tenha nenhuma ideia de pergunta, a gente colocou algumas palavras aqui, que são coisas que normalmente perguntam para a gente. E eu vou mudar para inglês agora, mas se alguém quiser fazer perguntas em português, pode fazer em português e a gente traduz, tá bom? So I'll switch to English. We have a few words here, just in case nobody knows what to ask. So this is some common questions we get. So it's just a few inspirations for you. But feel free to ask anything. So our panelists, we don't have the names here. So maybe I'll invite everyone to go up on the stage and introduce yourself. I think it's going to be... you can say... Come on. You can say your name, where you work, and your maybe your expertise, so you can receive the right questions.
Okay. I'm Gianna. I'm a machine learning engineer at Spotify. Very end-to-end, generalist machine learning workflow. So this is what you can ask me about.
Hi, I'm Eric. I'm a data scientist at Salesforce on the Einstein platform team, and I'm also kind of end-to-end machine learning. But before that, I did consulting, so a bunch of different domains. So I'm not really specializing in anything, just always kind of jumping around, whatever's most interesting.
Hello, people. I'm Thierry. I'm working for Nubank. I'm a data scientist there and also like a tech lead. I did a PhD in recommendation system, so that's kind of like my really good point. But otherwise, I'm pretty general also in everything related to machine learning.
Hi, I'm Chakri. I work as a senior researcher at Bloomberg in their quant research group. My expertise is mainly in quantitative finance and recently applying machine learning and deep learning techniques in the field of finance.
Hey, I'm Glaycon. I'm unemployed. But because I left my former company and going to start in a new company in like a few weeks, you know. But like, I'm working with like data pipelines, big data storage, and real-time processing.
Okay, so we have several different expertises here. So hopefully we can answer all your questions. But if you ask something that these guys don't know, we have lots of other experts here that probably can answer. Okay? So who wants to start?
So, hi, I'm actually going to cheat a bit because I'm going to ask the same question someone asked last night. So you're all experts in what you do, but I would like to know like a mistake you made and that it had an impact. And what did you do about it?
What mistake you made that had an impact and what you did about it?
I can't say that, you know, right? Like, besides deleting all production data, like, it means things like that. I think the one of the, not biggest mistake, but I think it's a mistake. It was to, we had sort of forecasting things that we wanted to do, you know, and everyone got pretty excited with TensorFlow, you know, and we after like a journey of trying to get this, it is like finding a problem for a solution, right? Like when you start using TensorFlow, most of the times you're just killing time until you find your simple regression that you can use on that, you know. So I think it was my mistake because I was leading this, you know, was to let this go and then to sign to the second fallacy of the big data, you know, like because the first one is that there is big data, it's a fallacy, you know. Big data is whatever doesn't fit on Excel, everything fits on Excel, you know. The second is that if something is not working, get more data into it, and more data, and more data. And we burn it like almost 1 year trying to get to a result where at the end of this 1 year, we close it up, say, hey, can we do that simply? You know, linear regression solved it. So.
W- we're pretty open about like mistake at Nubank. So usually we do like a lot of like meeting just to explain what we did wrong and why and how we can fix it. And I have like on top of my mind like two, mostly like related to what you shouldn't do even like in software engineering. One was a colleague of mine coming to me and saying, okay, well, you know, I just did like this two line of change in the code. It's like going to work, it's going to be amazing. Like just approve like the pull request. I'm like, okay, let me take a look. And like, it's really like a huge, you know, like amount of code and there was like just two line changed. And I'm like, yeah, I think, you know, that's fine. I think it's going to work. I'm approving the pull request. And then I think it was like Saturday. So I'm waiting and then I'm arriving to the office on Monday morning and then like people are just like coming at me and it's like, what did you do? It's like, it's like, what do you mean? It's like, nothing is working since Saturday. We don't know what happened. It's like, all data set is not running. Like everyone is stuck. I'm like, oh, okay. I guess, you know, like there was like this stuff that we just approved and it was like pretty bad. And I think they are like, they kind of like removed me like the access for maybe like 1 week. Like I couldn't merge anything anymore. But then like they gave me back after some point. Another story that I have is we have some tool for our customer service that is kind of like routing every chat that we receive to some team. So it's usually like this team is in charge of, you know, answering like some of the questions that we get. And we arrive at some point where we add like a new version of like a model and we just like deploy that into production. And the big mistake was that we did like, I think like this model deployment plus two other changes in some other code. And I don't know why, but like once stuff started like to crash, everyone was coming to us because they were thinking, oh, that's like our team with like the model that we just deployed that just messed up everything, which at the end was not even true. Like our model was working, it's just that we were not getting like the right data from like another team. So I guess again, like, you know, the conclusion is you shouldn't make too much changes on like the same day if, you know, like you don't have like enough tests or making sure that what you were like changing is not maybe like breaking some other stuff.
I can share something that I already shared with you in the corridors, but I can make it short. Yes, I spent 3 years like in love with like just the modeling part when I was very young, very academic at the time. So after these 3 years, it was about to, okay, I want to have my code merged. I want to have my algorithm that I've already published papers about how much better I can detect electrons compared to 40 years of physics research. And then 3 years later, it was when I left my like lab. I was like a lab nerd. And then I realized, okay, I talked to people in Geneva and then they were like, okay, but how fast is it? How much longer? We have 14 and a second collisions. Oh, okay. So I needed to make it faster. And then, oh, you're storing some features. Maybe we don't have like enough, the payload is too big. And I had to like reduce the dimensionality of my features and all of that. Then like when I finally, okay, it's approved, I'm gonna merge. 3 years later, it was conflict hell. It was SVN back then, more than 10 years ago. So eventually I fixed all the conflicts and then I broke the build. It was a nightly build and I had a memory leak. So not releasing early and often, not talking to people, not applying all the great agile and lean practices that I was not exposed back then in the academia was one of my biggest mistakes, I guess. Would you share one?
Sure. So just one thing I can think of. I mean, I've made lots of mistakes, but one thing I'll share is, yeah, similar thing, performance issues. So I merged something and I didn't fully understand how everything worked performance-wise, and then some models are just taking hours and hours and hours, but luckily someone else who's good with that stuff on the team found it and rectified it and kind of explained it, so it was a good learning experience, learned a few things.
So currently I work in a research group, so no one cares if I make a mistake because we didn't put any code in production, but so I can do whatever I want, no one cares, but just like career-wise, right, like I started my career in 2001 working in the .com. I wanted to work in a startup. So after my MS, I got offers from Cisco, Microsoft, and all these big companies. I said, you know what, I'm going to join a startup and make my millions. So I joined a startup. And then the moment I joined, after 1 month later, they started laying off people. It was 2001 April, I think. And every month, it was like every day, it was like you come to the office, you don't know if you'll have a job or not. It's a very stressful environment. And I mean, the important lessons learned are like you need to own something where you are kind of indispensable. I know no one is indispensable, but because of that, I somehow survived. And and then I decided to move to East Coast. And then I said, you know what, I'm going to join a nice investment bank and become rich, whatever, right? So I joined Lehman Brothers August 6th, 2007. Oh. So the exact day, that's the exact peak of the... So after 4 months, I get laid off. And I said, oh my God, what am I going to do? But I liked finance, and I was interested in quant finance. And I said, okay, I'm going to leave my job and do like a full-time master's in financial engineering. That will let you become a trader. That was my dream, to become a trader. And then next day, my wife also lost her job. She said, you know what, you're not doing anything full-time. Forget about things, just go back to your normal job. I said, no, I hate this. I want to become like a quant or whatever. So while I was at Goldman Sachs after Lehman, I did my master's in computational finance. And then we had two kids while I was doing my master's. I was working at Goldman. I was like almost killing myself every day, realizing, is it all worth it? What is the point of all this, right? But somehow I persisted. Luckily I didn't give up. And then I got the Bloomberg offer. And now, like, for the last 7 years, I'm the best part of my career. So again, this may or may not continue. But what I'm saying is it's important to adjust your priorities and focus on things. I don't know if it's a mistake, but these are some things. Like
next.
Hi. For those with software engineering backgrounds who wants to make the transition to data science, do you guys have like any advice, or do you know anything that helped with your knowledge when you've been through this transition?
Yeah, I can answer the question. One nice thing about data science, machine learning, and deep learning these days is that it's totally democratic. If you have motivation and time, all the resources are online. Like a lot of researchers and all the libraries are open source, like TensorFlow, PyTorch, Keras, everything is open source. And you have a lot of open source and like videos, like Stanford CS231 is all online, so you can look at the videos. So all you need is time and motivation. And my advice to you, especially if you're coming from the software engineering background, don't get overwhelmed with a lot of math. I mean, there'll be a lot of math, especially linear algebra. And just take it like, don't try to first learn the math, and it's better to start playing with the models and building something applied. And then also it's important to learn some math, but not like to the extent like you need to understand each and every algorithm, like all the math and all that.
I started at Spotify as a software engineer, even though I had like this academic background, and even though in all the different companies that I worked in the past, I would be the CERN girl that would do some quick hacks on machine learning and maybe not put in production at that time. So I started as a software engineer, and I was like, okay, I'm working for this product, and there's some data, so I'm going to have some fun. So have fun. Make sure that you raise the importance of hack days. So in Spotify, we have hack days every second week. And use it, because sometimes people, oh, no, but I have too much work. And then you forget that, no, hack days are super important. And if you, like, you can make something that works in one day, then like in the next one, and you can make it better. And then if you have like this time-framed mindset, it also helps you with like, oh yeah, I want to make small increments, and it also helps with this time frame mindset. And it also helps you to connect with machine learning people, connect with data scientists. So just like have fun, hack. And of course, there's plenty of resources. You can practice with Kaggle and open platforms, but also like practice in your domain, where you are, because it's easier to explain, like, what is this model doing with the data from the company that you're working or the organization you're working for, than with the hand, the MNIST data set, I would say.
Next.
I think one of the things that is most difficult about data science is to hire data scientists, because I really don't know when a person can be self-proclaimed a data scientist. What I've seen recently is you are a data science when you write it on LinkedIn. I'm a data science now, okay? And I've been talking to teachers who are trying to structure or to create courses in academia, I mean business schools, data science business school in business schools, or even in more technical schools, okay? So for us to hire data science, we want to know, what is a data science? What can I expect from a data science? And when can I consider myself a data science? Okay, so if you have any ideas on this, on what's the turning point, what is the event that now I'm a data science?
I mean, I think it's a buzzword these days, right? So everyone wants to say that they're doing data science. So from your perspective, if you're hiring, I would just be as specific as possible. Are you looking for someone to put machine learning models into production? Are you looking for someone to analyze your data and find trends and things like that? So I won't focus so much on the buzzword as think specifically what you want. And in terms of hiring as well, I've had a little bit of experience with that. I think one thing is it's a role that kind of requires a lot of different things, software engineering, some math and probability, coding, production level coding, statistics. So no one really often has all those traits. So, you know, look for someone who's curious and to strengthen somebody. I've seen people with a lot of different backgrounds succeed, you know, from really theoretical PhDs to people who didn't do any grad school or even finish undergrad, but were kind of really scrappy and hacking. So I think a variety of people can definitely succeed at it. So don't, you know, select people. I think look more for people who are willing to learn. Someone who's got like a curiosity and a strong base in one or two of the things can pick up the other things as well.
Hard to do that once you learn. This is the first. The second is that I had an experience trying to come up with a profile for data scientist, and I got a bunch of BI analysts. So, you know, like it's hard to define because it's kind of sort of merging. So I would go for curious people that are on online competitions if you want, like people really starting or contributing to projects, really. It's hard, especially in Brazil, it's hard, you know. Because if you go to statistics, you have a lot of good people, but they have very little experience coding, right? Or look for people that know Excel, right? Excel is data science, right? Big data, data science.
I kind of spend like a lot of time on that. I've been like doing that for almost like 3 years, and I hired maybe like the 15, 20 data scientists that we have. And as you know, like some people said, what you want really is, you know, to have some kind of like profile of what you're looking for. So again, like you will never find someone that is like a statistician wizard plus like a programming wizard plus I don't know, like good in like machine learning in general. Like at some point you need like to, you know, have like compromise, and that's where you need like to define, okay, well, if I want a statistician, like what is he going to do? Like do I expect from him to like write code? And if yes, it's like, does it need to be like production code, or is it maybe someone that I will just like attach to like a team and is just going to help the team, and maybe someone else is going to help him to like put this code into production? So I think we are like this change like this year where in some sense we are like starting to not just look at people with, let's say, like computer science background that know how to put code into production, but to start also like to look for people from, let's say, like economics background, statistician background, because we know that like those people are really valuable, and usually they will always like miss on like one of the points that we care about. But the thing is, like, you need some kind of, you know, like diversity, and you cannot just expect to have like computer science people like doing all the job, because at some point like they will just like the statistics background, or they will just like the just, you know, like business side on economics of understanding, okay, well, what are you like, what do you do, like the thing you do in the way you do, you know? So I think you need like a lot of this, and you need like diversity for that. And that's where, again, like you need, you know, to create those profiles. You need to understand what you're looking for, what you're missing in your team right now, and how can you, you know, like change that and find like the people you're missing.
Good afternoon. I think that we already talked a little bit about my question, but I would like to know if where you work, the people that are hired, they have grad school or some specialization, or they are open for just undergrad school people that want to learn about?
Usually when we look at, let's say, like the resume of someone, I almost like never look at like from where they're coming from. I always look more, like I'm more interested in like projects, what they can show, because it shows like way more than someone that just like telling me I'm from like Harvard. And maybe it's a good school, maybe you learn like a lot of stuff, but what I want to see is like, can you show me what you did? You know, like, can you like just show me like a project that doesn't have like to be like really fancy, but I need like to understand that, okay, well, you like put into practice what you learn. And I think that's what I care a lot compared to just, you know, like a diploma that even, you know, like when you arrive, I will never like ask you like for your diploma. Like, I don't really care.
I am a dropout from grad school, and I'm working at Spotify. So after 3 years of research, I was like, yeah, I need to go to the industry, and I dropped out. So, yes, you can finish grad school. I don't have any opinions about that. But you can also be, you don't need to have a PhD to start at Spotify. I also observe things like past performance, even in, when we talk about AI and bias and fairness, when we talk about AI and data for sports, like the models are based in past performance, and it's much easier not to be biased compared to other industries where the models are based on like proxy variables, and then like, oh yeah, if it's in this neighborhood, then this neighborhood is good for this outcome or not. So the kind of thing like university background is kind of a proxy variable, but it's not past performance. So I think we agree on the aspect of like, what have this person done in the past, how many projects, what was the learnings and the impact and their responsibilities in those situations. It's something that I observe around me, and I'm not talking specifically about Spotify, but like many different companies that when we talk about this type of questions.
Hello. I have a question about privacy. How are you guys preparing for the new privacy laws? Pretty soon we're going to have LGPD here in Brazil. In Europe there is GDPR. I know that in California they are writing some laws. I want to know how you guys are preparing for that. I know some obvious issues, for example, if you have a big warehouse right before Gauteng is a nightmare. Usually you need PIIs to train models. I just want to know how you guys are dealing with that in your own companies.
Data privacy and PII. I had like, I had two experiences with that. The most hurtful one was with GDPR, because that's kind of a full regulation. It's well thought and it's very long, and it had a due date, you know. I think the biggest challenge is, because we have been working with this before these regulations, right? So you get to some really practical aspects of how you store PII data, like private information. So if you have like, I had repositories of chunks of data with Parquet file that I was super proud of being append only, think again, you know, you gotta go there, clean up the information per request, you know, instrument your application. So these things are better done when they are built-in, not plugged, right? Models too. It took us like 3 or 4 months to figure out with legal department and a bunch of non-technical people with the models that we had trained. So what my company did was to match user profiles for EdTech. So it took us a long time to figure out how we use the information, if we needed to recalculate some models, if we needed to kill them, you know, which part of them we could use, because it's largely our models, at least, were largely based on past data and past repository of data related to impressions that we collected. So I don't know. I really don't have an answer for that. I know it's hurtful if you have terabytes of data that you have to reprocess. It's costly too. And as you said, like a couple of states in the United States gonna pass regulations. It's per state. It's not countrywide, so they might vary. Brazil is gonna pass regulation like this. GDPR, I think, is the most comprehensive of these regulations. If you model after that, you're gonna have a pretty good ground to adapt to other regulation, but it's painful. At least it was for me.
As Leighton was saying, I think like you cannot just expect to plug something and hope that it's working. It's like you have to kind of like thinking from the start, and it takes some time. And like you shouldn't expect like to think about like GDPR. Like in your case, I'm not sure like where you're working, but in your case, you shouldn't wait like the last few months and say, okay, well, now we're going to do like some work on that, because it's way more complicated than that, and depending of like the size of your company is going to be like hard or not. And what we've like, in our case, we have, for example, like a data protection officer that is like really close to all the regulation, that is always like keeping us in touch of, okay, well, what do we need to do? What are we missing? Is there like anything that we need to like move or transform in the way we're like processing the data? And I think like you will need help on this point, otherwise you will most likely like miss something. And I think for us, the idea is really like to put, you know, like the customer back in control of his data. And you should be like, you know, kind of like transparent from the start of like, this is like the data I'm collecting. I ask you for that. I will maybe, you know, like ask you again, because I'm not sure if you really understand like the impact of, you know, like all the data I'm collecting about you. And we've seen like a lot of examples from Europe. I'm from France, so I'm like kind of like following it a bit. And usually what you see is, you know, like you see all those people from like the first day just going around and asking like every company, I want to know like my data. I want to know, you know, like what you've been collecting so far. And you see like some really interesting case of like, oh, I didn't know that like this really small company was recruiting like this huge amount of data about me, because maybe like just a game or just something like this, and you're like wondering, okay, well, maybe, you know, I shouldn't use this app anymore, or I should do like something else. So I think it's really interesting for like the customer, and for like the company, you have to prepare, you have like to ask around, you have to really read like about the regulation, because it's going to be something that is complicated. And again, we've seen like example in Europe or even like from big company where I think when like GDPR was passed and was implemented, like big company like Facebook was still lacking. They were like trying to find like some loophole to put like their company in some other country and say, oh, we're not processing data from people in Europe, but that's not really like the case. So it's like really hard. And yeah, like just think about it like for some time, because otherwise it's going to hit you hard, I guess.
Hi guys. I have a question. I think as a data scientist, we share the same feeling about the coolest part of the data science pipeline is the modeling. I want to think about you guys, what you guys think about like companies like Robot or A2O.ai that are trying to keep this part modeling automated. How do you guys see that the data science will look like in the future? It's going to be just like cleaning and merge data sets.
Actually, there is a new paradigm right now. It's called AutoML. And there, what you do is you just pass in the training data set with the X and the labels Y, and out comes a totally trained model. So it's absolutely no need for any data scientist tweaking different hyperparameters, because everything is automated. but obviously this needs a lot of compute resources. So Google Cloud and Amazon and all these Azure also, they're providing this. I think H2O AI also provides this AutoML. And I think AutoML is something that will most probably happen in the future. Like, that's what everyone will be doing, because currently data science is very empirical. Just because LSTM is a new model or some new research comes out saying that their approach is the best, it's not the case. It depends on the data set and it depends on the problem. So data science is still very empirical. You have to try out different models with different hyperparameters, and AutoML, I think, is the future. There, you don't need any data scientists, but mostly once you prepare the data set and pass it to the algorithm, we just need to eyeball the results and see if it's making a mistake and try it out, and then, again, that's my personal opinion, which may or may not be right.
So at Salesforce, on the prediction builder team, we do a lot of AutoML. So essentially, we have a point-and-click app, so admins and can go through their data, select the columns they want to predict, and set it up. So yeah, it's definitely something that we believe in and we're going all in on, but it's it has its own whole slew of challenges itself, because you don't take the approach of developing that domain knowledge from the data, and you just have to kind of learn something. You learn how to do machine learning, so a lot of the issues are figuring out stuff about the data, like if you have label leakage, automating the feature engineering based on the types, these sort of things. So I definitely think it's something we're going to be seeing. A lot of people are doing this a lot more in the future, and it's quite interesting. It has its own slew of problems associated with that as well. But I mean, for some of these, the AutoML pipelines have parameters and different settings and things to test. So is there going to be something to automate that as well? It's, hard to say. But interesting to see how it plays out.
I just want to add something. Is usually, if you do like data science professionally, you will see that like the modeling part is usually just like 10% of your time, and 70 to 80% of like the rest is just finding where is the data, or you can like merge it together, like what kind of feature engineering you can do. And that's something that is like harder like to just automate. It's like I have in my disposition maybe like 100 different databases table that I can merge, and I'm wondering, should I just like merge all of them? Is it something that we should do? I don't think we should, because otherwise you just end up with like some really huge like data set that maybe like doesn't make any sense for like the problem you're trying to solve. And then, I've played, for example, with like Data Robot, and I think it's really interesting if you think in terms of something, like maybe like smaller company where you don't have like that much table, which is really easy like to just click and have it like running. But when you arrive to like a certain size, you need to have this expertise, this inventivity of, I think, maybe if I use this feature with this feature is going to be better. Or even like if you automate, a lot of this stuff, the issue is maybe you will have like a really good model, but then you cannot like explain it. At some point, if GDPR is arriving and one of the features is you getting the age, you multiply that by the income and you divide that by another feature, how do you explain that to the customer? It might be really good, but doesn't make any sense, So it's a bit hard. And I think there is a niche for a lot of company that, don't have a team or cannot recruit data scientists. And I think it's really good for them. But when you arrive to a certain size, then you have different kind of problem, and then it's a bit harder to just use that, for example.
So in finance, there are some additional challenges. One thing is when, for example, Bloomberg, what we do is we provide alternative data sets. That's what investors are increasingly looking at, right? Looking at the sentiment from news stories or tweets so that they can create trading signals based on those, or looking at supply chain data, or looking at ESG, which stands for environment, social, and governance, or other financial documents. So for all these things, especially where alternative data sets are involved, creating the labeled data sets is a big challenge, because, for example, if you have a tweet or news stories, someone needs to go through, read the news stories, and tag them as negative, neutral, or positive. And typically what we do is we outsource to companies like Crowdflower or Amazon Mechanical Turk or other vendors. And they don't have financial expertise, right? For example, we have seen cases where whenever there is a word like overweight, they say it's a bad, it's a negative, because they take it literally. But in financial jargon, overweight means it's go long that stock. The research analyst is saying that his overweight means he wants to buy that strongly, buy that stock. So you need some domain expertise. So unfortunately, when we outsource the data preparation to other companies, we need to have resources either automatically or manually eyeballing those data sets to fix the data issues. Because if you feed in those data sets to like AutoML, it's going to learn the mistakes, right? It's going to learn the overfit to the errors. That's one thing. And the next thing is the model interpretability. When we are, for example, Bloomberg is providing these sentiment scores, which are generated from machine learning models, and we send them as enterprise data feeds to our customers. When they want to make a trading strategy based on those scores, they want to understand and trust the model, right? If you do a totally black box model, like, hey guys, you know what? We are doing a bidirectional LSTM using BERT, the latest trend. They don't care, even though the accuracy might be better. They would rather have a logistic regression that they exactly understand how the model is making its predictions. Or we use some other techniques like LIME or SHARP. They have some new techniques where they provide interpretability on top of deep learning models. So model interpretability is important, and preparing the data sets and making sure to check the data errors is important.
Hi, talking about privacy yet, do you really try to run any DLP, data loss prevention tools because in production? Because I try to run little POC and it isn't good and wasn't good. And do you, anyone of you try to run that? Data loss prevention?
Can you just repeat the question, please?
Do you try to run any tools of data loss prevention? Data loss prevention?
His question is about privacy, and he said that he tried to run data loss prevention tools in production, and it didn't work. So that's the question, is if you had any experience with that.
You mean external?
Don't talk about MongoDB.
It's for free, right? Thank you. Finally, you know, I don't need to do these jokes anymore. Finally, someone else doing that for me. Thank you. I don't know if that's what you mean, but I'm working with a consultant group that tried to recover the data, not loss in terms like Mongo, you know, like say MongoDB, which is what you intentionally try to lose your data. But that this company had a suite of tools that, but they run that, and they try to infer a PII from your models and look for data repositories that were exposed. And it was the same company, same group that found a repository of Brazilian data, like the ID data, open to part of the internet here in Brazil. But I never saw any sort of this tool that I couldn't run by myself, you know, if that's what you meant, like data loss.
You have 5 minutes
so
to go next.
How do you guys learn new things? Like, how do you guys keep update with the field? Like, during the project, do you guys like reserve a space for research? Do you guys read books, academic papers? What is the process?
Reddit? I'm sorry. I learn by doing. What is exactly what they were saying. You know, I've tried to follow Kaggle, Reddit, and a couple of people on Twitter, like Fabiani, and so, you know, like, so I like things that are boxed, but it's easier to me to see a blog post than to try to parse a paper, you know, to really go deep into that, it's harder. But when I see like a notebook I think Google does that in Azure. They have a repository of notebooks that you can either run their models and algorithms, or you can do yourself and start changing it. That's, at least to me, hands-on is the best way.
Absolutely, I agree. What I do is I try to read the archive papers if there is some new research coming on. Or also, like Medium is a very nice place for looking at the latest blog posts on. There is a section called Towards Data Science. I follow that. And GitHub, like a lot of these researchers put their code and research on notebooks on GitHub associated with the research paper. So I download those and try to run those and adjust them to work with my use cases. But yeah, I mean, it's unfortunately, it's like really bleeding edge. It changes every day. And it's hard to keep up with, especially deep learning space, like too many things going on at the same time.
Yeah, I'm just following Reddit. I'm also on Twitter. And otherwise, like I used to have some kind of like Google Scholar alerts on some of the topics that I really care. But like I was getting, I don't know, like an email every week with like 10 papers and just like not possible to like read them all and parse like what's happening inside. So usually, yeah, I kind of like trust like Twitter and Reddit to kind of like curate everything for me. And then I just like pick, you know, what I feel is like interesting in my feed and go and read it.
I guess the academic in me is always kind of fighting that urge when, oh, that sounds interesting. Let me spend a bunch of time reading papers and figuring out how it works. So I'll still read some papers. I think it's fun. It's a good way to get kind of a deeper knowledge into something. So it depends what you're looking for. Sometimes you just want to learn the theory and get a good fundamental understanding. Another thing I like to do, maybe a little more applied, is just other companies. A lot of companies maintain a lot of good tech blog posts about the machine learning work they're doing. So it's a good chance to, and other things as well, software engineering, it's a good chance to kind of see the ideas, what other people are doing, ideas they have, problems they have. A lot of times, they're the same problems you might have, or they're problems you have and you just don't know it yet, so there's no sense kind of recreating the wheel. And then one thing I think we do at work a lot is a lot of brainstorming. We'll have kind of research presentation type meetings. So we have a problem, and then someone will kind of spend some time investigating it. And again, just looking for answers wherever possible, getting some ideas, and then we'll kind of, just got a bit louder here, then, you know, kind of prioritize them, try them out, you know, just the combination of coming up with an idea, implementing it, trying it out, experimenting. If it works well, great. If not, go back to the drawing board. So I'd say recommend typically not going too long without ever just trying something. I think I'd agree that doing stuff is the best way to learn.
Yes. Other than everything that was already talked about, I think currently I work with 5 different machine learning engineers, and I'm the one leading the function in the moment, and then I really try to foster like conference and knowledge sharing. So we have like bi-weekly knowledge sharings where we share maybe something about our product, maybe something about a tool that we explore during Hack Day. So again, Hack Days is also a good opportunity, not only to explore possibilities in your product, but also to learn. It's up to you to balance those things. But knowledge sharing is very important in the team that you're working with, but also Spotify is famous for like the guilds. So we have the machine learning guilds, and we have in Stockholm the fika, which is our coffee with a dessert. And there is someone giving a talk about some important topic. So making things predictable and regular in multiple scales. So, okay, it's a new year. What are the major conferences? There's KDD, there is Applied, and it's really great to be there. Okay, some people should go to KDD. This year it's in Alaska, who's going to KDD? And then like, oh, some people that like more the research side should go to ICML. And then we all, like, I ask people to share about their key takeaways. And this is like conferences, but then there's local meetups, and there's, I really like this connection with people, with real human beings, more than the Reddit aspect. But like I'm a ex Google reader person, so now I'm a Feedly person. So following blogs, of course, all of those things. But connecting and learning from others, my favorite style. Conferences are great for that. And even if you don't go to the conference, you can watch the videos. I haven't been to TensorFlow Dev Summit, but I can watch the videos and all of these things, and QCon's being recorded. You can recommend your friends that are interested in some topics to go and watch the videos.
Okay, unfortunately, our time is over.